tonight. Government reconsiders its approach to the proposed border control unit and heads back to the drawing board. Dallas police accused of trying to smear Botham Jean's name after reports that marijuana was found in his apartment. The director of the National Trust and the Police Welfare Association crossed swords over the demolition of the old Bridge Street prison. And ASLP writes to the police commissioner after a newspaper article alleges that party members are under investigation by police. Good evening. Welcome to the Friday edition of the DBS News World with me, Kendall Burton. We start with news that the Cabinet of Ministers has appointed a team to undertake extensive and in-depth dialogue on the establishment of a single border control management entity. This after customs officers staged protest action over concerns about the structure of the unit and their job security. The Cabinet has also taken the decision to revoke Cabinet Conclusion 247 of 16th April 2018, which previously addressed the establishment of the entity and sparked the customs officers' protest action.
The Cabinet-appointed team is to engage and discuss with all stakeholders on the appropriate structure for the proposed Border Control Management Agency. The team is expected to submit a detailed report to Cabinet by December 2018. In order for this to have meaningful effect, the Cabinet has also taken the decision with immediate effect to revoke Cabinet Conclusion 247 of April 16, 2018, which previously addressed the establishment of the entity.
The government has decided to revoke Cabinet Conclusion 247 of 16th April 2018, which had previously spoke to the establishment of the Border Control Management entity.
One of the key stakeholders, the Customs and Excise Department, opposed the move by the government on the grounds that its officers would have to reapply for their jobs and that their future would be insecure. Government has committed itself to taking into account all the concerns and recommendations of the stakeholders to ensure that St. Lucia's borders are secure.
What we want to do is make sure we have a more effective system in terms of the protection and the management of our borders. And this involves us taking into account all the stakeholders. And this does not involve removing or having people lose their job.
The Border Control Agency is expected to bring the police, marine and quarantine units, as well as the Customs and Excise and Immigration Departments under one umbrella. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
United States Attorney Lee Merritt has accused the Dallas police of being less interested in pursuing justice than in smearing the name of recent shooting victim Botham Jean. He made the claim on Thursday after Jean's funeral service and after a Dallas police affidavit released the same day said that officials found marijuana in Jean's apartment. But Merritt, a lawyer for the victim's family, says the search shows the police are attempting to discredit him.
The very day that funeral services for Botham Jean were held in Dallas, law enforcement officials made public a detailed search warrant affidavit listing items investigators recovered from the unit of Botham Jean, who was shot to death last week by Dallas police officer Amber Geiger. According to investigators, two fired cartridge casings, one laptop computer, one black backpack with police equipment and paperwork, one insulated lunchbox, one bulletproof vest, two used packages of medical aid, two RFID keys, and the most surprising of all, one metal marijuana grinder and 10.4 grams of marijuana were found in the kitchen. Attorney to the Jean family, Lee Merritt, has described as unfortunate law enforcement's attempt to smear Botham Jean's reputation.
I think the evidence is telling, not of what it was designed to tell, which was to besmirch the image of Botham Jean. His image is above reproach. But it's telling of the nature of the investigation into this homicide. In particular, the goals of the Dallas Police Department at its outset, this warrant that was executed on his home was specifically designed to find drug paraphernalia in a homicide investigation where yesterday. He was the clear victim when he was shot in his heart by a Dallas police officer in his own home. The knee-jerk instinct of the Dallas Police Department was to find evidence that would criminalize the victim.
The attorney accused investigators of operating poorly and slowly and of conducting a one-sided investigation. Whether or not Botemje had marijuana in his apartment, his attorney says, is irrelevant.
And I think in the process, Botemje's legacy will expose the corruption, the institutional corruption in the city of Dallas. If they weren't up to their same antics, these antics they play in every case, and we've been able to overcome them in other cases, but we typically only are able to get justice for a family. And I believe that we'll get justice for Botemje's family. However, because this case is under such great scrutiny and because it's so important, not only locally but nationally and internationally, I believe that it will begin to expose these tactics that they're trying.
Dallas police officer Amber Geiger was charged with manslaughter for shooting and killing Botemje in his apartment last week Thursday after claiming that she thought the apartment was hers. She was arrested and charged with manslaughter 3 days later. However, attorney Lee Merritt believes murder should have been the better charge. She remains free on a $300,000 bond. In the state of Dallas, murder carries a sentence from 20 to 99 years in prison. For the DBS News World, I am Sheffield Gillard.
The director of the St. Lucia National Trust has responded to the president of the Police Welfare Association, his expression of support for the planned demolition of the old prison on Bridge Street. The trust successfully got the demolition stopped by the High Court, but the PWA president wants to see it proceed and the site converted to headquarters for the police and fire departments. Bishnu Tulsi calls the PWA president's statements strange. He spoke to Alex Busquet.
The director of the St. Lucia National Trust has responded to the claims of the president of the Police Welfare Association that criminals are taking refuge in the old prison structure, which stands yards away from the police station. Tulsi says the statements are true, but also very strange.
I find the comments from the minister and the president of the Police Welfare Association very strange. They are both admitting the criminal activities taking place within the police compound, and the best way to solve it is to break down a building. I am still trying to understand that thinking. One would expect that the safest place and the place where there should be no crime is within the police compound. So I don't know what to make of that comment.
The director of the SLNT says the trust understands that the police need new facilities and acknowledges that they work under extremely difficult conditions, but he says he does not believe the old prison should be torn down to accommodate new police headquarters. As it stands, he says, he does not even know the reason for the demolition.
Is it to provide additional space for the police, or is it for the construction of the Hall of Justice, which is also being mooted? If we are taking on a project to improve the criminal justice system, it is strange that we will start that project with an illegal act. It's a very strange commentary, because as far as we know, the demolition work started prior to approval. We don't even know if approval has been granted for the project. We don't know if an application has been submitted. We have asked for that information, but it's not forthcoming.
Mr. Tulsi says research has shown that closed prisons have been put up to all kinds of uses. The nature of the organization, he says, requires the trust to think more about building than about breaking down. Now that the demolition has been stopped, Mr. Tulsi is hoping that the government can engage the trust in a conversation. For the DBS News World, I am Alex Busquet.
Talk show host Rick Wayne, meanwhile, has taken issue with the St. Lucia National Trust for attempting to preserve what he referred to as the derelict Bridge Street Prison. The demolition was halted on Sunday, September 9th, after the St. Lucia National Trust filed an injunction with the High Court. Don Nicholas has that story.
These are the photos of the rundown Bridge Street Prison, which have sparked controversy between the Police Welfare Association and the St. Lucia National Trust over the preservation of the buildings. talk show host Rick Wayne observed that the prison had been in a deplorable condition for many years, and judging by its appearance, Mr. Wayne feels there's nothing to preserve.
That prison represented just about the worst in humanity imaginable. And Kenny Anthony said to me that he was going to have a new prison facility.
In Mr. Wayne's view, the prison should have been demolished ever since the Borderly Correctional Facility was constructed.
That prison, like I said, I don't have the authority to determine it should be preserved. I don't know what there is to preserve. I don't know what there is. That thing should have been broken down and flattened out the minute Kenny Anthony had done his good deed, I gotta hand it to him, of Baudelaire.
The Sinusian National Trust filed an injunction with the High Court to stop the demolition of the old facility. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
Time now for Street Vibes. Here's Alex Buske.
Hi, I'm Alex Buske, and you're watching Friday Funnies on Street Vibes. The short-tailed dog, or the butu-tailed dog, with all his speed, could not make it around the straight corner. He fell down, he tumbled. Why do you think he could not make it around the straight corner?
Because he had too much speed.
He had too much speed?
So he ain't got control.
Okay. And that's why he fell down?
Yeah.
So what are you saying? He couldn't make it?
He couldn't make it.
Because, why he couldn't make it?
Well, yeah, I mean, the speed he had, he didn't can really make it.
Around the straight corner?
Yeah. So he had to fall down.
Probably the tail itself.
The tail?
Yeah, the tail.
So what do you say, the off-balance?
Off-balance. Or something like that.
But it's the tail?
Maybe, probably.
Because it have a butu tail.
So what are you saying, that it was off-balance?
Yes, because the tail couldn't swing how it wants. So it never had a tail to swing.
So the tail is important?
Yes.
No, with all that, it didn't make it because they had so many people, you know, that will watch it, you know, and that's the thing.
The short-tailed dog, or the butu-tailed dog, with all his speed, could not make it around the straight corner simply because there is no such thing as a straight corner. You've just been watching Friday Funnies on Street Vibes with me, Alex Buske, down here at the Aquarius Crossing, the intersection of Coral and St. Louis Streets. With that, we'll take you back to our studio.
You're watching St. Lucia's Television and News Leader and listening to us on Rhythm FM 95.5. We're also online on the big screen at the Aquarius Crossing in downtown Castries. Still to come, the SLP writes to the police commissioner after a newspaper article alleges that the party members are under investigation by police. And the National Youth Council demands answers on a $12 million US dollar deal to overhaul local sports facilities. Welcome back. The St. Lucia Labour Party, SLP, has written to the police commissioner, Severin Moshery, expressing concern about statements made by Mr. Oswald Augustine, the general secretary of the United Workers Party. The letter is in response to an article written by Augustine and carried in a weekend newspaper in which he alleges that that members of the St. Lucia Labour Party, or SLP, have been under investigation by local law enforcement and are expected to be brought to justice. More from Sheffield Gaylord.
The newspaper article accused the woman of impersonating someone in authority. Augustine claims that police have successfully collected information against the offender, who is expected to be brought to justice. The article also claimed that a top Israeli investigative officer is presently on island and is expected to assist local law enforcement officers in curtailing the leaking of sensitive information.
How does Mr. Augustine get possession of information that law enforcement officers have successfully collected and yet to act on? And why does he feel empowered to make such a revelation? We view Mr. Augustine's statements as a suggestion that in his attempts at getting to political opponents, he has the benefit of access to the machinery and operations of the police in St. Lucia.
The opposition believes the statements are threatening and should be a source of grave concern to the citizenry of the country.
The SCP is just informing the Commissioner of Police that they're very concerned that this is a dangerous, dangerous precedent in the politics of St. Lucia, where an operative of the United Workers Party is stating publicly that the police have information on opponents or so-called, and then they will act upon it.
Such actions, Mr. Jabatis notes, can cause the general public to lose confidence in the police.
Citizens are expected to trust that the actions of our police are above board and are not exercised on the whims and fancies of political operatives like Mr. Augustine.
The SLP is calling on the police commissioner to calm anxieties that such actions may cause to the citizens who rely on the impartiality of the Royal St. Lucia Police Force by making a public statement on the matter. For the DBS News World, I am Sheffield Gillard.
Former UWP Government Minister Richard Frederick's appearance at Sunday's march organized by the St. Lucia Labour Party has not escaped the notice of talk show host Rick Wayne. Frederick's constant criticism of the Prime Minister and his cabinet, coupled with his appearance on the opposition platform last weekend, have fueled speculation that he may join the ranks of the SLP. Here's Don Nicholas with that story.
Complaining at the time. Talk show host Rick Wayne made reference to a statement made by former UWP government minister Richard Frederick at Sunday's march that he is not dependent on politics for survival. Mr. Wayne took note that the statement was made on the platform in the presence of old political rival Dr. Kenny Anthony.
Well, it was very interesting hearing Richard Frederick say that with his back dangerously turned to Kenny Anthony, who was sitting behind him, directly behind him on the platform. Thought that was very brave.
Mr. Wayne recalls that not too long ago, Mr. Frederick was accused of selling St. Lucia's patrimony.
He was complaining at the time that Richard Frederick was giving away our lands, selling our lands.
Opposition leader Philip J. Pierre has dodged questions about Mr. Frederick's future with the St. Lucia Labour Party. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
The National Youth Council has called on the government for more consultation on the Parker Company and its managing director Donald Lockerbie's contract to overhaul sporting facilities around the island. This is after a leaked document alleged that the government signed a deal with Lockerbie to provide sports program management services to the sum of $12 million. Sheffield Gaylord has details.
The St. Lucia National Youth Council has expressed concern about the contract awarded to Donald Lockerbie. The government entered into an agreement with sports project management firm The Parker Company and Donald Lockerbie to provide sports program management services for local sporting facilities. The SLNYC believes the more than $30 million deal paid for by taxpayers is not justified. As the council's president notes, St. Lucia already has several sporting facilities, the maintenance of which has been poor to absent.
A lack of a program which can, or a system which can properly maintain those facilities. We ask ourselves the question also then, how will we be able to maintain the new facilities that are being proposed? In such a proposal, we would have hoped to have seen something that would cater to the facilities which already exist, most of which are grassed beyond usability. They are not accessible to the young people in the various communities.
The youth organization believes they are being left out of the discussion regarding the development of sports on the island, with the majority of athletes being youth.
It is no secret in St. Lucia that a lot of our associations are not functioning properly. So if it is a situation where the consultations were done, but with these associations, it might not always represent the view on the grassroots level, because a lot of these associations, they don't meet with their affiliates as regularly as they would need to in order to get the grassroots view on these particular issues. So we feel that proper consultation, that is definitely a flaw of the proposed plan moving forward, and that is something that we would really like to see improved.
Alfred noted that local facilities are not up to international standards, which could be attributed to local athletes' poor performance overseas.
A sport such as swimming, for example, St. Lucia has been calling for an international standard 50-meter swimming pool for the longest time. Our athletes go abroad, they've been forced to train at a 25-meter facility we have at the Rodney Heights Aquatic Center. That facility, it has its limitations, of course, because the international standard is 50 meters. And that poses a problem for our young athletes when they go abroad to compete in 50-meter pools. And we have to admit that competing or training in a 25-meter pool and training or competing in a 50-meter pool, which is the international standard, is completely different. And with the proposed plans, we're seeing that there are two new 25-meter pools proposed for Mikud and for Soufré. So if we already have an issue with lack of the proper facilities for our young people competing abroad, why build two more 25-meter pools that are not international standard?
The organization believes the money spent on the two pools should have been spent on building one 50-meter pool in a centralized location. For the DBS News World, I am Sheffield Gillard.
The youth power group YPG will be hosting its Help Break the Silence activity on Saturday, that's September 15th, at the VG Sports Complex. The activity is designed to raise awareness of suicide and to encourage people with suicide ideation to speak up.
We have seen many youths in the country suffer with depression, with suicidal thoughts, and mutilate themselves with blades. And we have been receiving a lot of reports in our YPG office about the situation. And tomorrow, we're going to be together, united with the youths from Vilfort, Denis Soufré, and as well here in Castries, together to help these youths that are in need of a word of faith, a word of encouragement to change their life.
The group is also hoping to get more young people to join its ranks.
Well, my story was, before joining the YPG, I was aggressive. I hated my mother. I used to smoke, drink, party, and that was my life. Depressed. When I was depressed, I would go to drink, I would go to smoke with my friends. In that time, that's what I would get that's what I would get happy, by drinking and smoking. But after getting to know about the YPG, my life changed a lot. I don't have to drink anymore, to smoke anymore, to have fun, to be happy inside. I am happy.
The event will feature live music, spoken word, and dance performances. When the news continues, more students benefit from scholarships and bursaries. Stay tuned. The St. Lucia Electricity Services Limited Lucilex Scholarship Program boasts 29 members. The now more than 30-year-old program has to date benefited more than 100 children. Ahead of the start of this new academic year, Lucilex hosted its annual scholarship social to recognize and motivate its student scholars. We hear more in this report.
29 children of parents employed with St. Lucia Electricity Services Limited Lucilex are members of the company's scholarship program. This year, 4 students also received one-time bursaries. The 5 new entrants were welcomed to the program at the 13th annual Lucilex Scholarship Social, where top performers Chelsea Branford, Abby Pulte, and Tammy Pulte were recognized for their achievements in the previous academic year. Open to children of employees who are successful at the common entrance examinations, the Lucilex Scholarship Program began in 1985. The now 33-year-old program pays for all school fees, uniforms, school books, school bags, notebooks, CSEC, and CAPE exam fees throughout secondary school and the Sir Arthur Lewis Community College. Chairperson of the Lucilex Scholarship Committee, Assistant Human Resource Manager Tandy Flood, spoke of the expectations the company had for its student scholars.
Take this moment in. Hold on to today. When you meet the inevitable challenges that school and life has to throw your way, remember this moment, that what brought you here, because it is those same qualities and characteristics that will get you through anything. In this academic year, 2018-2019, we are confident that our students will excel.
To maintain the scholarship, each student must achieve a minimum of 65% grade in each subject and an overall average of 70%. Lucilex Managing Director Trevor Luisi encouraged them to put in the necessary effort to remain part of the scholarship program.
It's important that you make these sacrifices. You know that you manage your time properly, and if you are consistent at doing that, so you start early and you're consistent throughout the term, I can guarantee you are going to be successful.
He challenged students to go beyond the expectations of the program, telling them, "If you do what is easy, your life will be hard." He also had a special message for the parents of the scholars.
Parents, you have a role to play as well. You have a very important role. Encourage your children. Encourage them to be a better version of themselves. Sit and study with them. You will be surprised how much you will learn from them. They need your support now more than ever. They need that extra push when things get rough. They need your reassuring words when they get discouraged. They need to hear your applause when they do well. The successes achieved at the end is not only theirs, it's yours.
The scholarship social was held at Lucelec Power Station in Cul-de-Sac under the theme Limitless Possibilities to Achieving Success. For the DBS Newsworld, I'm Chela Mendez reporting.
Meanwhile, on Tuesday, September 11th, the Elx City of Castries Cooperative Credit Union announced the beneficiaries of its scholarship program. Justin Hippolyt and Bree Lewis were selected as the scholarship recipients for their academic performance at the 2018 Common Entrance Examinations. Bursaries were also granted to Elijah Lewis and Shannon Williams.
The students and their parents gathered at the credit union on Tuesday for a brief presentation ceremony where they were addressed by Director Winsbert Regis, who is also the chairperson of the Education Committee. Mr. Regis addressed the students, reiterating that they need to stay focused during the school year.
If you have the will, we have the way. Okay? So I want to congratulate you on when you go out there, be your best and be all that you can be. Stay focused and to keep your grades up. And know where that you're going. And like famous Les Brown would say, you go where there is no path and you leave a trail.
Students were in receipt of a check of $1,500 each, with bursaries being $500 each. The scholars will attend the St. Joseph's Convent and the St. Mary's College and will be required to maintain a 70% average for the 5-year duration of their scholarship, while the bursary recipients will attend the Castries Comprehensive Secondary School and Entrepot Secondary School, respectively.
First and foremost, I'd like to thank Elks Credit Union for this scholarship, and this scholarship will go a very long way in assisting my parents with educational expenses.
The Elks City of Castries, located on the corner of Brazil Street and Coral Street in Castries, is a cooperative financial institution serving people living and working in Castries and the environs. The Elks Credit Union is proud to offer the scholarships and bursaries, as this is just one way the Elks Credit Union adds value for our members and assists them with increasing costs of higher education while emphasizing our commitment to their financial success. For the DBS Newsworld, Chela Mendez reporting.
Stay tuned, we have more news coming up on the other side of this commercial break. On the lighter side tonight, police in Washington State shared 3 photos of creative carpool lane cheats, including one who used a Halloween skeleton as a passenger. The Washington State Patrol shared 3 photos this week showing the 4 passengers that high occupancy vehicle lane users used in unsuccessful attempts to ward off scrutiny from police. One of the photos featured a Halloween skeleton dressed in a jacket and a baseball cap. This driver, NB15, at 1405 in Snow County, was dying to not get caught with this passenger. There's no bones about it. Another HOV violator stopped by WSP. Trooper H. Axman, the Washington State Patrol's District 7 Public Information Officer, tweeted. Another example tweeted by Trooper Rick Johnson of District 2 shows a pillow dressed in a hoodie and holding a cup of coffee and a tablet. Axman also shared a photo of a creepy dummy that appears to be composed of a mannequin wearing a surgical mask, a hoodie, and a pair of glasses. HOV lane violations are punished by a $136 fine in Washington State. That's your lighter side and our news. I'm Kendall Burton. Before we go, let's take one more look at our top stories. Government reconsiders its approach to the proposed border control unit and heads back to the drawing board. Dallas police accused of trying to smear Botham Jean's name after reports that marijuana was found in his apartment. The director of the National Trust and the Police Welfare Association crossed swords over the demolition of the old Bridge Street prison, and ASLP writes to the police commissioner after a newspaper article alleges that party members are under investigation by police. And that's the DBS News World for today, Friday, September 14th, 2018. On behalf of the entire news team, as wishing you a safe and restful evening and weekend. Stay dry.